We can talk a little bit about arthritis and probably set the stage up for the rest of the sessions this afternoon, talking about shoulder replacements. The topic is, what can you do short of that in athletic, high-level patients, and what options do we have? So traditionally, you can live with it, try medicines and injections, or do a replacement, partial, total, reverse. It's interesting to see the reverse shoulder climbing so much across the world, and we can talk a little bit about the why that might be. Current options for an arthritic shoulder in an active patient living with it usually doesn't work out well. We really don't have any data on how any of the non-operative treatments work that well. Arthroscopic options can be effective, and we will talk a little bit about that and some of the other options with that. Replacement, resurfacing, short, regular stem, and then the question is, what about activity level? This was a 58-year-old, very heavy weightlifter, had a total shoulder, came in because he could no longer lift. And so the question for all of you that like to do reverse over anything else and maybe on the panel before is, if you have someone that wants to bench press 300 or 400 or 500 pounds, are you going to put a reverse shoulder in him and tell him he can go back to the gym and do that? Or are you going to put it in and tell him he could never bench press again and that's all he does? And he's going to be disappointed if you say no. So the accepted treatment usually when you sort of do things is age greater than 60, sedentary lifestyle, reasonable cuff gets a total shoulder. Age over 70 with a rotator cuff tear gets a reverse. But there's a lot of people with arthritis that don't fall into those categories. And this is one of our revisions. And if you look at the glenoid, clearly you had a pegged glenoid, kind of dysfunctional, cuff, you know, has some scarring. And so where are you going to go with this in a patient that wants to maintain an activity level? So surgery under 60. Arthroscopic debridement, which we've been doing since the arthroscope was invented, has very mixed results. Replacement, Rockwood at one point said only hemiarthroplasty. Cofield has refuted that. Mattson likes a ream and run. Total shoulder arthroplasty is a treatment of choice, but very unsatisfactory if you look at Sperling and McCarty's work in younger patients. And is it really the problem of prosthesis, or is it the subscapularis? Where does that problem exist? And so maybe not active, who knows? So the other question is, why do younger patients do worse? Why does a 40-year-old with an arthritic shoulder do worse? Well, it's not a fair comparison. There's usually trauma in the past. There's scarring in the capsule. There may be rotator cuff. The anatomical status is more impaired, and they're demanding more out of your operation. If you have a 35-year-old and you put a reverse in, there's a 20% failure rate in 2 years. And I don't know that there's anybody in the room that really enjoys doing revision reverse arthroplasties for bone loss and infection. It's not a fun case. All right, so younger solutions. Maybe think outside the box a little bit. We're going to give you three or four of these and see about what happens. And you just kind of look at it as a long-term solution. So if you see someone that's 35 with an arthritic shoulder, they've probably got to exist with this for 60 more years. And I would submit to you that there's nothing we have in our armamentarium that will last 60 years that you can do on the shoulder. There isn't anything. A reverse shoulder is not going to last 60 years. So what are you going to do for that patient? So you got to think about, well, maybe I could scope it and clean it up. Well, it's an arthritic joint. You're not going to correct arthritis. We don't know how to cure it yet. Maybe you're buying time until somebody wins a Nobel Prize for thinking of that, but we don't have that right now. But you can take everything out, try to take care of everything other than a total shoulder, and so see what happens. So this is one, if you look over here on the left, there's a ton of loose bodies here. There's a coracoid spur, a little arthritis at the AC joint. Ed would not call this a downsloping acromion that's sitting very close, but maybe you could change that a little bit and take care of some of that. And so this is that gentleman. He's a triathlete, couldn't swim, went in, took care of everything else. Basically, the best thing I did for him was clean out his AC joint so he could cross over when he does his freestyle swimming. Was very happy with it. He's now 15 years out from that, still doing triathlons, has not gone to a total shoulder, even though his joint was the one, the arthroscopic picture that I showed you. What about resurfacing options? So on the glenoid side, we learned this from Buzz Burkhead. On the humeral side, from Steve Copeland, offers mentor and senior partner, passed away, great guy. And so this is one of the things that we looked at. So when you're thinking about glenoid resurfacing, there were two concepts. One is flat patches, and the other is the lateral meniscus. The lateral meniscus would be a force concentrator. So my colleagues that said they were going to use the lateral meniscus, it actually makes no sense. The humerus does not stay in the center of the glenoid. It tracks in a figure of eight pattern. So if you do use the lateral meniscus, it were all going to fail, which is what happened. And then humeral side, you can look at those other things. So resurfacing is a buying time and activity option. And so when we let them have normal activity. So this is how this works. Clearly, this patient has had a lot of surgery. Humerus is still round, which is important. The glenoid looks terrible, so we'll measure it, we'll abrade it, we'll microfracture it. You can do this for some very mild B2s, and we'll cover that kind of at the end of the talk when we do this. And so we'll go in, clean it all up, abrade it, microfracture it, and then we'll slip a dermal patch in. It's very similar. It's actually much simpler than an SCR. And so this is a dermal patch that sits on the top of it. You've got to create a bed. I don't think you really need to do a capsular release, but you need to take off any humeral spurs when you do it. And it tends to work very well. It gives you a nice, smooth, flat surface for the humeral head to roll on. And so we hold them for about 4 weeks while it sticks down. Again, you've done a lot of microfracture and decompression of that glenoid and then start them moving. This is one of the guys we did. We now have 15 plus years on this initial group of 20. We had 5 early failures, which were pretty much square humeral heads. I made a mistake on those, but the other 15 still haven't operated on them. Minimum of 15 years follow-up. And this guy is exactly this tall. He's 5'4 and 425 pounds. We had to use hip cannulas when we put it in, but he's continued to do very well and works offshore. Rob Hartzler just looked at Joe DeBeer and Steve Burkhart's ones at a minimum of 10 years, and it's a 70% success rate. So overall, 7 out of 10. Don't have to have a total shoulder. Don't have to worry about glenoid loosening or all the things we talked about in the previous panel. What do you do with a non-concentric humeral head? I realize in Europe this never happens, that you have a failed latarge like you see here with arthritis and subscap failure. Never happens, but does happen in the U.S., and so we do see this sometimes. So what we want to do is what we alluded to just a minute ago, is a subscap sparing approach. We don't do this in older patients. What we're going to do is we'll take the subscap down if you're 65, 70, 80, and we're going to do a total shoulder. But for younger folks, this is what we do. And so the initial exposure is a delta pec. It's about a 5-6 centimeter incision, as you see here. We then define the borders of the subscapularis. We talked about in the last session with the panel how important it was to release the inferior capsule. And so Laurent and I actually came up with this subscap sparing approach at the same time. He went from the top, I went from the bottom. And it ended up that we were both probably half right. You should split the interval, which gives you more laxity. You've got to go to the bottom because you have goat's beard spurs and an inferior capsular contracture. And so we find the mid-level, sort of, and I take down the bottom muscular part of the subscap, and then we'll make a horizontal split, just like you see here. Try to do it about two-thirds of the way down as you get more experience. If you're doing it for the first time, do it halfway down. There's a very nice raffet that you can use for that. And then as you do this, as you come around, you can slip a cob in, pop the subscap up over the top, deliver the humeral head. You're basically dislocating it inferiorly. And people do this all the time with an intact subscap. We know all traumatic instabilities. And then you can see the head. Then you can cut it if you want to do a stemless arthroplasty. If you want to do a resurfacing, you can just do that. And so very nicely, a lot of times we'll do a resurfacing, as you see here, pop it back in, and then that's the intact subscap on the right. And really, you don't have to do any immobilization post-op. It's a very rapid recovery. And so post-op, this is one of my patients. He's actually an orthopedic surgeon, and he was one day post-op, and he was showing me before he came in what his motion was like at the first day. So it's pretty good. He didn't have a block. He pulled his own block out. And so we don't restrict them in any way when they do this as well. And so we looked at 50 patients that we did this on. The subscap was intact by ultrasound. Some of them we MRI. We tried to do that, but we ultrasound all of them. All the clinical exams were negative. And then durability, we looked at 120 of these with a minimum 6-year follow-up. Only 3 of them did we have to convert them to a total shoulder. 115 of them would do it again. However, if we asked, do you have no pain in your shoulder, only 42% said they were completely pain-free. The other 58% were taking some kind of medication like anti-inflammatories or Tylenol, but were continuing normal activity, which is pretty good. And this is a young lady that had destroyed her humerus, and she's 38 years old and also very active, as you see. This is one of mine because the concern is always about destroying the glenoid. And I think Steve Copeland nailed this when he did his surface replacements. We did not have glenoid deterioration when we used his prosthesis. Doesn't happen with that particular prosthesis. Cannot talk about when you do a stemmed implant, but Copeland was right. And then quick note as I finish up on eccentric arthritis, when you have something like this, these applications don't apply. This is the one why arthroscopic debridement was uniformly unsuccessful. That's a burner show view on the bottom right. I can't fix that with anything else other than a replacement of some kind. Now, different from Gilles, and we've argued about this in the past, is that I do think you can do a total shoulder. So this is a 58-year-old, very fit, did injections for almost 6 years trying to hold off and finally couldn't do it. This is what he looked like. This was his Bernageau view, and so he didn't want to change his activity. So we did a posterior augment glenoid with bony ingrowth, something I learned a little bit from Philippe Valente, that the better the bony ingrowth, the better we're going to do. And so that's what it looks like. And then this is his five-year x-ray with an augment glenoid and a Bernageau view, still centered and doing reasonably well with an intact cuff. He's keeping his weightlifting under 300 pounds, and so we're very grateful. So, again, total shoulder arthroplasty for non-concentric arthritis. You can do subscap sparing, but you got to be cautious about it. And you really want to just restore the anatomic balance, which is what we talked about. So, and then reverse, I would caution you a little bit. It's a miracle for pseudoparalysis. It's the only option I really know that works for that. The incidence is going up and up and up, and you can listen to the prior panel where everybody moved to reverse right away. I do 4 revision reverse shoulders a month. I never walk out of one of those and say, oh, I did great. I'm so happy I got to do this operation. I walk out and tell the family, look, if the arm doesn't fall off in recovery, I'll be really happy. It's a miserable operation. So before you jump to a reverse in a 35-year-old, just think about who's going to do the revision. I will fortunately be retired in about 15 years, so it's going to all be on you guys, and I won't have to do them, but it's a very scary thought. So younger patients with arthritis are becoming more common. They have high demands. Bone and soft tissue preservation is the key to keeping them satisfied. And think long terms and in stages, not just let's do something really easy and not worry about the future. Thank you.